Welcome to Incognito, the podcast, where we uncover and explore how people from various fields and disciplines create inclusive communities and workplaces. In today's discussion, I am joined by a deeply spiritual thinker. Jamie is a much-recognized scholar and teacher who is an expert on the work and practices of Sargent Shriver. Although I came to Jamie's work as the executive director of the Sargent Shriver Peace Institute, it was his book about Shriver's methods with the highly enticing title, Spiritualizing Politics Without Politicizing Religion, that drew me to have a conversation with him. And what a conversation it is. As a theologian, professor, and peace builder, he approaches the conversation thoughtfully and with great care. I hope you'll find this dialogue as spiritually uplifting as I did. Welcome to Incognito, the podcast. I'm your host, Michael Fosberg, and with me today is Jamie Price, and he is the executive director of the Sargent Shriver Peace Institute and research professor and founding director of the Insight Conflict Resolution Program in the School for Conflict Analysis and Resolution at George Mason University. He is also an affiliate professor in the Mediterranean Academy of Diplomatic Studies at the University of Malta. He serves on the board of the Sargent Shriver National Center on Poverty Law and writes articles and essays for a range of scholarly and popular publications. Previously, he was a faculty member in the Department of Philosophy at Georgia State University and the School of Theology and Religious Studies at the Catholic University of America. Jamie's research focuses on the theory and practice of method in peace building, the role of religious imagination in creating and transforming culture wars, and the philosophy and peace building achievements of Sargent Shriver. He holds a PhD from the Divinity School at the University of Chicago and is also the co-author of a new book titled Spiritualizing Politics Without Politicizing Religion, The Example of Sargent Shriver. Welcome back to the podcast, Jamie. It's good to have you.
It's good to be here. It's good to be here, Michael. Nice to see you.
Nice to see you too. It's funny. I was thinking, how do I start this? We're laughing at this, but we've tried to do this numerous times and been thwarted so many different ways. And so it's good to be able to connect with Jamie and to delve into some of these topics that he has some expertise that he could share with us today. And I want to start right off the bat by going back to your bio and talking about, well, first of all, how impressive it is, of course. And we all know the bios are sort of just a listing of our professional accomplishments, but I want to know more about you personally in this question, and I want to know how you would describe yourself and what identities are core to how you see yourself in the world.
I see my identity, as I think about my identity, I honestly think of it as shifting depending upon how I'm performing the role I'm in. So you listed a lot of roles that I've had in my past, and my identity sort of rolled with each of those roles, whether I was a professor at Catholic University or at what is now the Carter School at George Mason University. My role as somebody, my identity as somebody who updates biographies isn't high, so we say. But I think of my identity as my felt sense of myself in a particular role. And that my sense of myself as seeking to be my best, my most authentic, I know that's a word you like, person, but of all of them, the ones that I most identify with, that are probably be my role as a thinker, as a scholar, as a husband, as a friend, and as somebody who's trying in very modest ways to help the culture move forward on some of the difficult problems we have today. And I'm lucky enough to have been able to work for the last 18, 20 years with the Sargent Shriver Peace Institute and focus my attention on Sargent Shriver. So I do definitely have a role of interpreting him and understanding him. And if you hear a dog in the background, it's because I have a dog.
We have your friend joining us. I'm caught first off by the first thing that you answered, which was about this shifting identity from the different roles that you play. And I was speaking with a previous guest on the podcast, and I was sort of comparing that to somewhat to this idea of code switching.
Uh-huh.
You're familiar with that?
Yes, I am.
Yeah, so the idea that we are using language in different ways, or the way that we speak in different ways when we address different people in our lives, whether it's family members or a member, I don't know, authority figures or students or whomever it might be, we sort of shift the way in which we address them or talk to them. And I think in some ways, our identities are along that line, that same line, that they're shifting in the roles, in the various roles that you play. It just makes complete sense.
Yeah, I think so. And that's the code switching, or the notion of being carried along by a code, is, I think, absolutely true. We are conscious beings, but we aren't just amorphously conscious. We're also in a role, using a language for a particular purpose. And so the way we use our minds, the way we use our feelings, the way we're oriented to ourselves and to each other is carried by those things. And, you know, I'm sure it's happened for you. You can be cooking something. Let's say you're making lentil soup, and you're not thinking about, and then so your mind and your heart and your care for whoever you ask, you're cooking for, are operative there, and somebody can interrupt somebody like me saying, Michael, I can't make it to the podcast, and suddenly you're shifting roles entirely, and you're no longer thinking about the soup, you're thinking about me, and you've got a different code, and you've got a different identity working. I mean, they're complementary, of course, and we carry them, but I think the notion of being carried by those things, so our consciousness being guided and directed, is what's interesting to me about it.
Yes, wow, this takes me off on a tangent here. I don't know if this is fair to go here or not, but I'm thinking about an exercise that I often do with students, which is called Stream of Consciousness. And I do with writing students. And what the exercise tries to do is, the stream of consciousness is this idea that there are millions of thoughts running through our minds at any given time, but our filters or our brains help us to focus on what you're making lentils at that moment, until it changes when you come in, you step in and say, I can't make it to the podcast. And now it changes, it moves my filter over to that concentration. But that doesn't mean that I'm still not thinking about the lentils or the million other things that were going on at the time I was making the lentils, right? And so
that's right.
What I'm trying to engage the students in is to get them to write as many of those crazy things on the, to try to grasp all those things and to write them on the page. And it makes me kind of think, again, along the lines of identity and how it's constantly shifting and changing in the way that we, like the roles that we play. What part of us is in that bio, and what part of the bio defines who we are, and
totally
those shifting roles.
Yeah, it's we are polymorphous in that way, I think.
Yeah,
as some philosophers refer to it, and. It is interesting. I would think your students would be quite interested in having you help them pay attention to how multifaceted and multi-carried they are at any one time.
Right.
And to see that come out in the words.
Yeah, it's kind of an eye-opener for them.
Yeah, but it doesn't open their eye, does it?
No.
It opens that, yeah.
Their mind.
So it's a self-presence opener. So, I mean, that's what's so great about it, because we have sensory experience is easy. Our eyes are good.
Yes.
But to pay attention, and that exercise sounds great, to pay attention to how we're actually using our minds at any particular time is harder to do. I mean, we cultivate it in our roles, I think. We get better at it. But anyway, because it's at that level, that you can think about talking about being present to the spirit as well. But you have to be able to differentiate those levels of experience.
Right. Boy, we could go deep into consciousness, talking about consciousness here, but I don't want to detract from the through line here, which is...
You're just carrying me, my friend. I'll go where you want to go.
Okay. I want to get right to the meat of the things. Spiritualizing politics without politicizing religion, the example of Sargent Shriver. I would love it if you could share, as you have many times, I'm sure, in the past, who is Sargent Shriver, and how did you become interested in his work?
Sargent Shriver, he died in 2011. He was 95 years old, so he was a major figure in the 20th century. He was, I'll just give you some descriptors, so sort of like a bio. He was President Kennedy's brother-in-law. He was married to Eunice Kennedy Shriver, who started Special Olympics International. Maria, Bobby, Mark, and Anthony Shriver are his kids. He was very dedicated as a father, but he was probably one of the most effective American peacemakers in the 20th century. He started he desegregated Catholic schools in Chicago at a time when that was being mandated by the courts across the country, and did it very creatively and without any violence or stress. No, I mean stress, but without any violence. And he was also, did I say, he started the Peace Corps.
Haven't gotten to that yet. Yes.
Yeah, he started the Peace Corps. He devised it and built it. And then after Kennedy was assassinated and Johnson came in and wanted to end poverty, he ran his effort to end poverty. He took his insights from how do you make peace in the world to how can we make peace across lines of poverty in this country. An incredible effort during a six-year period of time that has impacts on the country today and is still wildly controversial. Shouldn't be, I don't think, but it is. And then he went on to do many other things, bioethics and nuclear arms control and interreligious dialogue and the internationalization of Special Olympics. And he just worked and tried to build peace. And by building peace, I just mean create structures that would enable people to cross boundaries of race and language and identity.
Yeah, yeah.
So he was an impressive character. And yeah, I've been lucky because I knew him for about 20 years. Oh, you asked me how I got to know him.
Yeah, that's right.
His son, Tim, who's been a friend of mine for a long time now, and my boss. It's funny how that works. But the...
He was a former student of yours. Is that right?
That's right. That's much more clean way to talk about this. You're very good, Michael.
Yes.
Yeah, he was a student of mine at Catholic University. He was getting a master's in spirituality there, and I was one of his main professors. And we did a lot of work on spirituality and spiritual consciousness and so forth. So as he was talking at home, and his dad wanted to meet me, and he introduced me, and then they had started a program for their dad called the Shriver Peace Worker Program. It was the 75th birthday present for him. And it wasn't going as well as they liked, so they asked me to think it through, help them think it through. One thing led to another, and at a certain point, I became the director of that. And that's how I got to know him. And then that led to the creation of the Sargent Shriver Peace Institute in the early part of this century. And my goal there was to figure out what Sarge was doing when he was doing all the things he was doing, and to help other people do it. And in that process, I wrote the book.
Yes. Yeah, that's a pretty impressive bio for a guy.
Sarge? Oh, yeah.
Yeah, wow. Yeah, you can't top that. So there's just so many, such a wide variety of connectors that he oversaw, whether it was peace building or nuclear or interreligious or all these different things in which he was tasked with bringing different people together.
Right.
And so my question is how did he go about doing this?
I mean, there's two levels to answering that question, which is simpler to ask than anything. There are the techniques he used to do it, but there's also the sort of fundamental framework that he came at all these tasks with.
Could we talk about the framework and then the tasks? Is that
sure? That's great. The framework, he was a spiritually grounded person, and that's crucial, but maybe I shouldn't start there.
Okay.
It's absolutely crucial to him, but he did not believe that people were, he did not believe Hobbes. He did not believe that we're in war with everybody else. He believed that we are here because we're connected and because we are spontaneously interested in being compassionate, in serving each other, and committed to each other's, all evidence to the contrary, committed to each other's security and well-being. And he knew that at our most authentic sense of self, that's where we were going. That's where we were tugged by the spirit. And he just saw everybody that way. And it was impossible for him to go at problems where the assumption was, well, that person's out there to get me. That person's out there to take advantage of me. That person's out there to promote themselves rather than anybody else. And he created the Peace Corps, for instance, in a way that set people up to live that way. To set people up to engage, I mean, set Americans up to engage with foreign nationals in a way that assumed and that made the assumptions live that we were committed to each other to make friends, to build peace, to collaborate on security and justice.
Is it fair to say that we have more in common than we have different?
Yeah, you have such a great, succinct way with words. I wish I had it today. We have more in common, and part of what we have in common is a love for each other that we're out of touch with, is a respect for each other. And we have a dignity that is intrinsic to us that deserves respect. Mm. And he just gave it. People thought he was too optimistic. They called him a Boy Scout. They, didn't believe that he could, that Peace Corps was going to work. But he was really also quite hard-headed about it. I mean, he wasn't just an idealist. He was he called himself, well, he used Gandhi's term, he was a practical idealist. And my term for him is that he's a spiritual realist, because he did not have the view that he had to fix all the barriers that we have. Mm. He did not have the view that it was up to him to make sure that you and I get along, Michael. That, mm. But he did want to set things up in a way. He did want to set the patterns up in a way so that if we were to encounter each other, we'd be positioned so that we would get along.
Yes.
So that I'd be asking you what you cared about. I'd be doing what you do in this podcast. You're wondering who I am. You're wondering who I am in my own terms. You're wondering how I've done. You're wondering all of these kinds of questions, which are very Shriverian in the sense, I mean, they're very fundamental in the sense of how do you cross boundaries? And that's what your podcast does. I mean, I feel it in the questions you're asking me. He did the same stuff, but he built it into his policies and into the roles and tasks of the Peace Corps volunteers.
So if we look at that as the framework, this simplified, more in common than different, then the tasks that he used to do that, I think you're sort of actually in the last few things that you mentioned are task-like. Is that right?
That's right. And it gets back to the question of role and identity, really, because it's how do you play? So you have your role. Imagine you're a Peace Corps volunteer and you're going to a foreign country. How are you going to cross the boundaries of being white, male, American?
Right.
I'm using myself as the basis there.
Yes, that's right.
How would I?
Yeah. So how do you cross
how do you cross those boundaries? You're put in a position where you have to find out who the other person is in their own terms, which means you need to learn their language, which means you need to live with them, which means you need to anchor yourself in their customs, mm-hmm. which means you need to say, what do you need and how can I help? And even though what the response is traditionally and typically, what do you mean, how can you help? You're an American, you must be here for nefarious reasons. You can't be here just to help. And the kind of strength and inner sense of self that it takes to put up with the rejection, to put up with the loneliness, to put up with the difficulty of just being present, to take on all those projections and let them not stick. And he set the role of the Peace Corps volunteer up to perform so that the optimal performance of that role would be to be doing all of those things. So you don't tell people how they should run their lives. You don't tell people what their problems are. You don't tell people, and you listen to who they say they are, and you offer to help, and you wonder if this helps. And lo and behold, you have lifelong friendships that come out of that. You have boundaries that cross language and economics and race and gender. Mm. And what you're trusting for that to work is not that is the fact that what I want to call the spirit is tugging us all in that direction anyway. Mm. I mean, we can't do it ourselves, but if we're put positions where the object of our role is to transcend ourselves, there's help. And Sarge didn't think he needed to do it. He just thought if he could release what he called the spiritual power of people, that it would change the world. And he was fully clear that if Peace Corps had been able to be created at the scale that he and President Kennedy first imagined, that it would have done more than it already has.
Hmm. Yeah, so this was all happening in the 60s, correct?
That's when it started, yeah,
1961. Right, in the 1960s. And I'm wondering if you could talk about the parallels between the time when Shriver was raised and when he, I don't know, crafted this focus of his work and today's agitated state or world.
Well, it certainly feels a lot like then, now. Mm-hmm. Polarization is high. The assumption that there are two different sides and one side is right and the other side's wrong. Mm-hmm. It was certainly strong then as it is now. May I ask you for a little more clarification on what you're hoping I would, I would draw from that?
Because... Sure. Well, I'm curious because here's this man who was, and you are steeped with his knowledge and his purpose and his mission, and have laid that out in your book so well. I'm curious as to that time period that took place when it was really evolving, the peace was evolving, the war on peace was evolving, and how he came to understand the importance of this at that time, why it was important, what was going on then. And then fast forwarding to today, here we are in, I don't even know how to describe the world in which we find ourselves, certainly perhaps crazier here in the United States of America than across the ocean. But are there examples, are there things that we can learn and take from what he did and apply them to where we are today?
That's very helpful. Yes, I do believe so. As a matter of fact, I think in the 50 years or so that have gone by, it's very much harder to think the way Sarge thought these days. I mean, he would say things like Peace Corps shows the importance of infusing spiritual values into the work of government. And those were just toss-off phrases of his in his speeches.
Yeah.
Or we can't, that government and religion have it, that both those organizations have at stake justice and peace, and they need to work together. And right now there's an alienation among those. The religious part of the contemporary culture wars makes it almost impossible to imagine, and this had its roots a lot farther than just the culture wars, makes it almost impossible to imagine how you could get religion and politics together in the public square without causing a fight that would blow things up. We've been experiencing it for the last year, and certainly since some of the recent Supreme Court decisions, more intensely now.
Yeah.
One of the things that he lamented was the fact that, and it was apparent even in his time, that it was difficult, but it's harder now, that it was difficult to think about the spirit as anything other than a private, personal, subjective event. I mean, this is something that I believe, maybe you believe, certainly Sarge believed. He went to mass every day. He prayed the rosary. He had a very deep spiritual life, cultivated it for all different kinds of reasons, but mostly to keep going and to keep on track. And as I was saying earlier, he didn't think that we could really succeed in building a just world without the help of the spirit pulling us toward becoming our best selves, pulling us toward self-transcendence, pulling us toward what's true, what's good, what's adequate. And even if we fail, then having the strength and courage to admit failure, to admit mistakes, and to go forward. Hardest thing in the world is to admit a mistake.
So. Oh. Yes.
You know, that kind of self-transcendence, that kind of movement beyond bias, whether it's group bias or individual bias, is very tough to do. And he knew that you couldn't do that without the spirit. And these days, it's hard to think of that as somehow in the public world. How do we create public policies? How do we create schools? How do we create school curriculums that make that central, or at least if not central, common?
Yeah.
And that is so Spiritualizing Politics Without Politicizing Religion, the title of the book, addresses that, because spiritualizing politics is easy to imagine. We know what it means if a spiritual tradition or a religious tradition says, this is what you ought to do with your body, this is how you ought to act, this is how the country ought to be run, and then leverages power to get the government to be its enforcement arm. That's what I mean by politicizing religion. So how can you turn that inside out and spiritualize politics? How can you infuse compassion, service, the pro-social spiritual values into it without turning that into a polarized melee?
Right. I would guess that many people might get caught up in the difference between spiritual and religious.
I suppose that's true. I haven't checked it in a little while, but a few years ago, at least, the Pew Center on Religion and American Life was saying that the fastest growing aspect of American culture, self-determination or self-denomination, was spiritual but not religious, not Catholic, not Protestant, not Jewish, not Muslim. Spiritual but not religious. So there's a fundamental distinction that people, I think, see pretty clearly between the institutional framework of a particular tradition, Christianity, Judaism, and the something greater that in various ways we connect to or feel is there or turn to in our hardest or deepest or most celebratory moments. Just say, help me, or just say, thank you, or just say,
right. Such simple requests, but coming from a deep place.
Right. And I guess what Sarge was clear about was that that isn't just an abstract belief statement, that there is that deep place, and you know this, that deep place is experiential. It's like we were talking earlier, there's the sensory, the conscious, and then there's that deep place, which is also another spiritual dimension, experiential dimension, which I keep calling spirit, but maybe there's a better word for it. Deep place.
Deep place, yes, that's it. Yes, I guess I feel that this is an important moment for us, and that's why I was so intrigued to be able to speak with you. Such an important inflection point on where we're at in our country in particular, but also across the world and the things that are going on. But in learning about Sargent Shriver's work, it just really made me think about what are the lessons here that we can apply to today's problems.
Yeah. Just before I got on this Zoom call with you, I checked my email and I had a couple more email requests for donations from political organizations saying, stop them from doing this. They're going to ruin the world if they do that. So, yeah, and we talked earlier about codes and how they carry us. And there's just the resistance to being polarized would be great if every day or every moment we could think of it, we just rejected the notion that we were polarized or had to be polarized, because there are so many things that lead us in the way that do it, lead us to think about that. Sarge's example is different. He would just say, that's a mistake. You'd have to stop and open up a conversation with a person and say, so tell me about this thing that you think is going to happen. Mm. What is it you're fearing? Why do you think that my sending you money to do this is going to be the best way to solve this problem? Mm. You'd have to be very, very intentional and concrete about finding out what's at stake for the other person. So it's not like you go from Sarge to simple lessons, 1, 2, 3, even though he had a tendency to do that. Like, here are the lessons, here are the things you have to do for the Peace Corps. You learn the language, you anchor yourself in the community, you commit to their welfare. That's true, but those are very, very difficult things to do. And so how do you not be a person who divides us into two groups? How do you pay attention from that deep place?
Yeah.
To commit to doing that, whether it's about race, whether it's about political polarization, whether it's...
Yeah, I have to say, I think what you just said is it's about conversation. It's about having dialogue. I mean, you just, Sarge's question or Sarge's response to these various emails would be, I need to know more information. I need to have a conversation with you, right? Isn't that sort of what you
that's sort right. of figured out? And certainly I think before I'm going to write a check. Yeah,
exactly. And so we're not having those conversations, that, and thus the language that we're using seems to be more polarizing. And this brings me to something I want to ask you about that I've also been really curious about is, can you talk a little bit, and I don't, maybe this is a bad segue, but it leads me to this. Can you talk about your work with the Insight Conflict Resolution Program? What is it and what is the mission?
Yeah, I'd love to talk about that. Insight conflict resolution is an approach to resolving conflict that I worked on and developed when I was teaching at George Mason University. And I've been doing it as part of the Sargent Shriver Peace Institute as well. But it started as these other things have, and reflecting on how did he actually make peace? What was going on in people's minds when they decided to say, okay, I'll work with you rather than not? Yeah. And so first step was to say, well, let's not talk about conflict as an abstract thing, or there's this conflict between whites and blacks, or men and women, or you and me. Let's talk about particular conflict behaviors. You just yelled at me. What was going on there? And so there was an analysis of conflict behavior, because again, it's at the conversational level, the micro level. And I think in conflict behavior, there are two factors. One is somebody's perceiving a threat. Somebody experiences something that they perceive as a threat to something they care about. There are various levels of threat, of course, but they perceive a threat. But more than that, they then decide to act on that threat to stop it.
Mm.
So if there's an apprehension of a threat and a decision to prevent it in every conflict behavior, then you've got something to work with. Then you've got a way to be structured and careful and open, and to say, so what was not just like what was going on there, but what was at stake for you when you did that, or what were you hoping to achieve when you did that? And it, you know, it enables us to defuse, or even a simple thing like, Jamie's a jerk. What did I do that makes you think I was a jerk? Because the decision to call me a jerk, or the decision to make a moralizing statement about anybody, which is sort of a common coin of conflict behavior anyway, that's one of the major things we do. There's a skip that happens. We feel the threat, we feel the dislike, we feel the anxiety, we feel the whatever that comes up that's negative for us. There's some sort of gap, that's what I meant by threat. There's some sort of apprehension of something missing in the situation. I don't like it. It puts me at risk in some way or another, and I want to either name it by saying Jamie's a jerk, or get him out of here by slamming the door in his face. But what it does is it's a carrier that doesn't have any ability to say, well, I'm feeling a threat here. I'm feeling a gap. Jamie's triggering something in me. I wonder what that is. The sad thing and the difficult thing about conflict is that it's really certain, it's really righteous. Typically the threats are so strong, even on the smallest things, that we don't, unless we have a strong self-presence, we don't really wonder about them. So the tactic of the insight approach is to open up that curiosity that's locked down, to begin to ask targeted questions about what was going on for the person, what was important to them, what narratives and images were carrying those on, were those images true? Did it make sense to do that? If that's what your goal really was, did it make sense to tell Jamie he was a jerk, or was there something else more important to you? So what was it about Jamie's behavior you didn't like? Oh, he didn't say hello to you when he came into the room. Well, maybe we can fix that. You know, I mean, they're just...
The
theory of change that's operative there, and that's operative in all of Sarge's work, is that every decision we make, particularly conflict behaviors, we use our mind when we do it. We apprehend a threat, we decide against it. The only way that behavior will change is if we change the way we're thinking about the situation. The only way we will change, it's not like I can't make you change your mind, but I can ask you how you're using your mind. And if I ask you how you're using your mind, and that deep place opens up and they start becoming more self-present to themselves, they'll go, why am I doing that? As soon as you become focused, your use of your consciousness, the flow of your consciousness, there's the opportunity for it to shift into a higher level and to become more authentic and to change. And then people stop. And we need to propagate that kind of work, to answer your bigger question from 10 minutes ago, more broadly.
That is absolutely what I'm getting at. That is so great. I mean, I think about it in terms of the work that we do in the DE&I space about unconscious bias. And we talk about that. And I'll mention that term and I'll get this glaze of, you know, faces looking back at me like, well, unconscious. Well, if I'm unconscious of it, how would I even know I have it? You know, and it's like we all have these things in there. And I think this conflict resolution work is sort of a great way to expose those unconscious biases. And I'm assuming that this was a derivative of your exploration and work around Sargent Shriver's work. You came to this conflict resolution work.
That's right.
Is there any, and I don't know a lot about this, we're hoping to have someone on the podcast in the future, but is there any relationship or connection to restorative justice work as well?
There is connection to restorative justice. There are pretty strong links to it. There's some technical difficulties. If you sit down and you have an insight manual and you have a restorative justice manual, we make different assumptions. But there's a lot to talk about. And the fact that restorative justice is linked to encounters between the person who is wronged and the person who wronged that person, and that often, you know, apology and acknowledgement of harm are key to those things, that's crucial for the healing and makes total sense in terms of insight.
Right. And we're assuming that there was a conflict there in which there needs to be some restorative justice to take place.
That's true. Yeah.
And, right. That's terrific. That's exactly what I wanted to get to. That's great. I want to ask you, and this is I don't know that anybody can really answer this question. I ask it all the time, but is there one thing that you could recommend to listeners that could act as a catalyst for a more inclusive society, or workplace? I mean, it could be a lesson, it could be a tool, a step, a rule, or even a story. Is there one thing that you think could really help be the catalyst, or a catalyst? It doesn't have to be the catalyst.
Yeah, I think I'd probably put it in terms of Sarge's son, Tim Shriver. He started an organization in the depths of the COVID crisis, thinking, here we go. We have a global crisis. Surely this will make us see that we are more united than we are divided, that there's more in common than not. All of us get COVID. All of us are threatened by it. All of us are at risk. And it wasn't as simple as that. So he's really interested in exploring how, if everybody could, and it's, I'm passing the buck down to Tim, but if everybody could just pay attention every day to the way that they, that their actions divide not others from them, how the things they do divide them from others, create boundaries, create barriers, and just try to cultivate growing mindfulness of how deeply immersed we are in the project of creating boundaries and creating barriers and creating divisions. That I think, I mean, it certainly feeds into what you were talking about earlier with unconscious bias.
Mm.
But we have a bias toward division, and we need to, if we're going to pull this out by the roots, that's the root we need to start at. And if it's going to be pulled out, we have to become aware, and we have to repent. And we have to seek if we can just not do that and all that. And that's a matter of being gentle about it. It's a matter of just paying attention and saying, ah, look what I just did.
Yeah.
There's plenty of remorse there once you start paying attention.
Yeah. That's requiring a big awareness, but I couldn't agree with you more. I think that's where we're at. It's a really important piece in what can help us.
It's just a piece. You're totally right.
Well, that's true. There are many pieces, but I think it's an important piece to live by. And speaking of live by, there, I did that transition. I know we touched on this a little bit at the beginning, and I know it is an obsession of mine, but I want to ask you what it means to be authentic. How would you describe that? And what does that look like for you?
If I am authentic, I am being my most genuine, my best self. Now, given the fact that so many of the carriers that we talked about lead me to distorted behavior and to bias, I'm going to fall short of that. But the urge is to be the most attentive and insightful and curious and open and responsible and free person that I can be in my engagement with the world and people I love and with my work. So it would be to be in my role, caring about the things that were pertinent to my role, operating within it in such a way that I performed myself, that I performed optimally, that I performed attentively and responsibly. And I don't think I can do that by myself. I don't think I'm capable of it. But I do think that there is, as I've said a number of times today, I do think there is the possibility of saying or asking for help.
I also love that you, and when you first started to talk about it, you also mentioned the idea of, the acknowledgement of falling short. And just having an awareness of that also, to me, adds to the authenticity. Is that?
Yeah, I think so. Because that's one of the deep, unfortunate truths about it.
Yeah. Yeah, acknowledging that is a key part, because it's acknowledging the present moment and the present state of mind.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, I could talk to you for hours about
it. Oh, you're very kind.
I want to wrap this up, and I want to ask you one last question. I want to ask you if you could recommend a book, a movie, or a play which has inspired you recently, and why.
You know, my wife and I, when we were on a road trip recently,
yes,
we listened to the audiobook of Lincoln and the Bardo.
Oh, wonderful book.
And I tried reading that to myself a couple of times, and I only got 60 or 80 pages in, and I just couldn't do it. But the audio version just was an extraordinary tour de force, I think, in exploring a very interesting spiritual dimension of the real historical events of the death of President Lincoln's son.
Yes.
And I found that very inspiring. I also watched Rectify. Do you know that television
series? I do know it. I have not watched it.
It's stuck with me. I've watched it a couple of times, actually, and it's stuck with me more than most. It's about a guy who gets falsely put in as a teenager. His girlfriend is killed during a prom night or something like that, and he takes the rap for it, and he's put on death row in a death penalty state, and he's released. His sister for 20 years fights for his freedom, and there's an attorney who fights for his freedom, and they get him out. And then how do you move forward in a town that thinks you killed this sweetheart of the town, and who thinks they know exactly what your identity is,
and
thinks they know precisely who you are, and you're already shattered? How do you move toward healing and wholeness? And it's done in such a beautiful it's not mechanical, but it's, moment by moment way, including failure.
Yeah.
That I just found it very moving too. I was sorry it was over.
That's terrific. That's a great series when you're sad it's over. I want to mention to listeners, Lincoln and the Bardo is by George Saunders. I'm curious, because it has lots of voices in it. Who read the audio version?
Oh my God. It does have lots. They had all kinds of famous names that I can't remember right
now. So it was more than one person. It was
more than one person then. Yeah. I think it won the Pulitzer Prize for the best audiobook of the year.
It's an amazing piece of literature, and I agree, it is. You really have to sort of get into the rhythm of the way it's written. I can see how it can be difficult to read, but now I'm curious, and I really want to hear the audio version. So thank you. That's great.
Sure.
Jamie Price, thank you so much for speaking with me today. I hope that we will revisit and perhaps have another conversation down the road.
Well, that would be a pleasure. Thanks, Michael.
Thanks again for listening to Incognito the Podcast. As always, we welcome your suggestions and encourage you to rate and comment in your podcast app. Rating and comments helps people find us and allows us to spread the word about this work. Also, big news on our end, you can find us on Instagram at Incognito the Play. Find us there, follow us, and hit us up with a question or comment. I'll be back again next week with yet another conversation that delves deeply into identity, authenticity, and ways in which we can create inclusive communities and workspaces.